Here are the spices we're going to use in our gingerbread recipe. We have ginger, cinnamon, cloves, and allspice. And we have the whole spice here and then the ground version here. So spices are all plants that contain a lot of flavor, and you eat different parts of the plant. For example, we eat the root, ginger root. We eat the bark of the cinnamon tree. We eat the flower bud of the clove tree. And we eat the berry of the allspice tree. So this is fresh ginger, and it is native to Southern Asia, Southeast Asia, and it packs a lot of flavor. When it's fresh, you want to look for a nice tight skin. It's a thin skin. You can peel it even with a spoon. You don't even need a knife before using it. This is a slightly aged ginger. You could hopefully see it's a bit wrinkly compared to this tight, smooth skin. That means that it's not going to have as much flavor because it's drying out. So when you're looking for fresh ginger, make sure you go for the nice, shiny, tight skin. This is crystallized ginger, which is dried and then dipped in sugar crystals. Nice little sweet and spicy snack. And then we have powdered ginger, which we will use in our recipe. Cinnamon, you peel off the bark of the cinnamon tree, the inner bark. It's native to Sri Lanka and India and again Asia. Most spices are tropical or subtropical, so they like those nice, warm, humid, sunny climates. And this is called a cinnamon stick or a cinnamon quill. You can cook with it, but mostly cinnamon is used in its powdered form. Cloves are extremely flavorful, and they even have a numbing property. So if you have a toothache and you're unable to get to the dentist for a few days, you can actually take some of this clove powder and you can rub it on your gums and it will numb that area. And also has an antiseptic property, so it kind of cleans things. Just like all spices, they have volatile oils, which to humans are really, really flavorful and delicious, and that's why we seek them out, and we cook with them, and we eat them. But smaller animals, including microorganisms, do not like the flavorful volatile oils. They're kind of toxic to them, which is why people put spices on their food to prevent it from spoiling. It slows the growth of bacteria. And most insects, most pests will not eat your gingerbread because it's just way too flavorful and it has those really strong volatile oils, which we like, but the little creatures can't take it. So the clove looks like a tiny little nail. It is picked by hand from a tree, and this is, as I said, the flower bud. So it's a flower that hasn't even blossomed yet. It hasn't opened, and you have to pick it before they open, and it can be ground into a powder. The allspice is a small berry from a large tree, and it has a flavor that's sort of a combination of these other three spices, hence the name allspice. And we're going to use the ground version. Okay, so here we have our roof, and we have 8 inches by 6 inches, and we have the front and back of the house, 8 inches, 9 inches, and again 8 inches. And you only need to make one of each because you can reuse them. So we're going to make an A-frame gingerbread house, which is a really simple, pretty easy
model. Think of it as your starter home. So first we need to actually cut out the pieces that we're going to use as the template to cut out the gingerbread dough itself before we bake it. And so I'm going to make the template in the regular paper, and then I'm going to do it in the manila folder, and I'll use the manila folder to cut out the gingerbread shapes. And if this doesn't make sense to you right now, don't worry, you'll see it and it will all make sense toward the end. All right, so starting with the triangle, what I do is simply take a piece of paper and fold it in half. And I know I'm going to be going, if it's in half, 4.5 inches, and then 8 inches. The ingredients and tools for making gingerbread are here. 1 cup butter or margarine, 1 cup molasses, 1 cup brown sugar, ginger, cinnamon, cloves, allspice, baking soda, and flour. And the tools, a measuring cup for liquid ingredients, measuring cup for dry or solid ingredients, measuring spoons, a whisk, a pan, and a bowl. So to make the gingerbread, first you melt a cup of butter or margarine over medium-low heat, and you're going to add to that 1 cup of brown sugar, no need to pack it, 1 cup of molasses, and you want to make sure you're using the measuring cup for liquid ingredients, and you're going to drop down to eye level and make sure you stop pouring the molasses when it reaches that 1 cup marking. Molasses and brown sugar are both made from sugar cane. When white sugar is processed, the molasses is extracted from it, and it actually is slightly nutritious. Molasses has iron and potassium. Brown sugar is a mixture of white sugar with molasses. So we have 1 tablespoon of ginger, of course, for the gingerbread. 1 tablespoon of cinnamon. 2 teaspoons cloves. 1 to 2 teaspoons of allspice. Then you'll heat the mixture on the stovetop, medium-low heat, until the butter is melted and the sugar is dissolved. Then carefully pour the hot mixture into a bowl and let it cool before you add the flour and the baking soda. You'll add 4 cups of flour gradually and 1/4 teaspoon baking soda. Level it off. And then 2 more cups of flour. Mix it with a nice sturdy wooden spoon or metal spoon. And then you're going to want a clean workstation. This is marble, but you can use anything. Sprinkle it liberally with flour. It's a very soft, very sticky dough, and so you're going to want to knead it with your hands until it is no longer sticky. And you'll have to add more flour as you go. Use flour on your hands and sprinkle more on the dough and on the flat surface. Sticky. And you can knead using the palm of your hands, pushing forward with the palm of your hands, and then folding, and then turning 90 degrees. Push, fold, turn. So push, fold, turn. But you don't have to knead that way. You don't need to knead that way. Just as long as you incorporate some flat. Divide your dough in half so you have 2 pieces. And now it's time to roll it out. So get your baking sheet first and preheat your oven to 350 degrees. Cut a piece of parchment paper to fit your baking sheet. And we're going to roll the dough out on the parchment paper, and that will make it easier to transfer it onto the baking sheet to bake. You can just slide it right onto the baking sheet after you've rolled it out. So you're going to need more flour so it doesn't stick too much. You can also flour the rolling pin. And you're going to roll from the center out. You want even thickness throughout the entire dough, about 1/4 of an inch, 1/4 of an inch, or a little bit thinner even. Add flour if it gets sticky and difficult to roll. And just try to make sure it's very even so that it bakes evenly. Can kind of feel if it's thicker in one part. All right, then grab your cutouts for your A-frame gingerbread house. You've got the roof, a rectangle, and then the front of the house, a triangle. And leave some space between the 2 shapes because when they bake, they will expand and you don't want them to bake together into 1 piece. Sharp paring knife, and you're just going to carefully cut around the shapes. Don't push down too hard with your hand that's holding the shapes. You don't want little indentations in your gingerbread.
Just gently hold the piece of paper in place. And you're going to do this twice. You do the same thing with the other ball of dough so that you'll have two roofs and two walls. Then you're going to peel away the extra dough and you can just roll that out for your next shapes, or you can make some gingerbread people, some cookies. There we have more dough. Then you're going to remove the paper, slide it onto a baking sheet, and bake it for about 7 to 8 minutes in a 350 degree oven. You'll know it's done when the edges are a little bit brown, and when you press it, your finger doesn't leave an indentation, it bounces back. So this part's tricky. I just took it out of the oven. It's hot. You have to be extremely careful. And you have to act fast because the gingerbread, when you first pull out of the oven, is still a bit soft. So this is your opportunity to trim any excess because it does expand a bit during baking. So we want our house to be precise. And so we just are trimming it down to size, making it more precise. If it's too hot to hold, use a kitchen towel to protect your fingers. Just don't press down too hard on the dough. And you can eat those trimmings. Let them harden and then eat them. They'll be nice and crunchy and delicious. Set these aside to cool and harden, and then bake the other two pieces. Now you can make royal icing. You will need 3 egg whites, 1 pound of confectioner's sugar or powdered sugar, same thing, 1 teaspoon of lemon juice, or you can use 1/4 teaspoon of cream of tartar. I'm using lemon juice in this example. So I have my 3 eggs, I have my powdered sugar, I have a lemon, it's important to have a clean bowl for this. You don't want any fat, any egg yolk, anything contaminating the icing because it can ruin the texture. And for a piping bag, we're just going to use a regular Ziploc bag. It works great. So first you need to separate the egg white from the egg yolk. And I like to do this using 2 additional dishes. So you're going to crack it open and let the egg white carefully fall into the bowl and transfer the yolk back and forth between the 2 shell halves. Try to avoid getting any egg yolk in the egg white. And try to avoid getting any egg shell in the egg white. And using a small white bowl makes it easy to see if there are any egg shells. And you can just remove those as needed. Now get your electric mixer and on medium-high speed, beat the egg whites until they have stiff peaks. Just takes a few minutes. You'll see they look foamy and they hold their structure. When you've reached the stiff peak stage, you can dip your spatula into the egg whites and they will hold their shape and they will not fall off the spatula. I'll show you in a minute. And after that, you're going to add your lemon juice or cream of tartar and your confectioner's sugar. And mix, mix, mix. It's a pretty stiff icing. Pretty firm. And I'm going to put it in this Ziploc bag and then cut off the corner tip and use it as a piping bag. To create a base for your gingerbread house to sit on, you can use a plate or a platter or a tray, or you can just use a piece of cardboard and cover it with foil. So I just cut this from a box that I had, and I'm covering it in foil, and that way if you give it to somebody, you won't need to worry about getting the plate back. You could cut it in a circle if you want. And here we have our base platform, our two roofs, our front and back of the house, and our royal icing in our piping bag. So make sure you don't cut too large of a tip. You don't want the icing gushing out everywhere. You want to be able to control it as it comes out, and have it be fairly thin lines of icing. So start with a small cut on the corner, and you can always make it bigger. Don't start real big. So now is a good time to call a friend as you assemble it. And we're going to just first assemble it without icing so you can see the parts, and then with icing. So you see the two roof pieces on this A-frame are actually the rectangular pieces, and they come together at the top, the seam of the roof. If it's not a perfect even seal, that's okay. You've got lots of royal icing to fill it in and hold it together, and it looks like snow. All right, so once you've sort of put it in its place, you want to mark on the foil where each piece will go, and that's because you'll need to know where to put the frosting. And I'm gonna pipe a line on the base first. Now another line for the large roof, and then go on the top of that front left side, because the rectangular roof will actually rest on that triangle. So stick it in the icing and then on the icing. So you're building your structure, and it's good to have someone holding it in place as you continue with the icing. The icing is really like a glue. It hardens and becomes quite stiff and holds everything together. So I'm now piping the top left side of the triangle for the front of the house. And the roof will sit on it. And it's sticking pretty well. You want to be very patient during this part and use lots of icing. Ice wherever gingerbread touches. It's a good idea to put icing on the top of the roof where those two seams fit together, and any other places where there's a gap. And then let the icing harden. You really want to give it time before decorating it, because if you put a lot of candy on it and the icing is not dry, then it can collapse, which is very sad.
Ah, ginger, 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 ah, ginger you're naughty, but you're naughty and nice. Say gingerbread, 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 gingerbread. You're full of sugar, you're full of spice. You're kind of naughty, but you're naughty and nice. My heart does crazy every time I'm with you, but your mama says you're much too young today. We meet on the corner and we share a kiss or two. How long did your mama think we'd wait? Gingerbread, 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 gingerbread. You're full of sugar, you're full of spice. You're kind of naughty, but you're naughty and nice.